Greetings and welcome to the East Coast Anti-Federalist Show. My name is Brutus and I'm joined today by Quina Bianca. We can be found online at www.ecaf.us, that's E-C-A-F or face spelled backwards. We can be reached with questions or comments at info@ecaf.us. And next we are going to have Kona's Corner.
Latin word for today is paene, P-A-E-N-E. It's a preposition and it means almost. It's often used it's always used with a noun. You'd say almost something. So the Latin word for island is insula. So paene insula means almost an island. And that's where we get what word?
Peninsula.
Yes. So when you see pen, it means almost. Like in penultimate, yes. Almost the ultimate. Ah. Next to the last.
Okay. Yeah.
Pen is an English abbreviation.
What's the word for smart or intelligent?
I don't know. Clever. Calidus.
Calidus?
Yeah.
So Obama is paene calidus.
As Rush would say, he's too clever by half.
I have a question. I have a Latin question, actually, for you on that, because I was studying my Year of the Five Emperors in Rome, which I've developed this great fascination about it. Apparently, okay, after Commodus, whom you all know from the movie Gladiator.
We sure do.
The son of Marcus Aurelius is assassinated. The throne is bought by Didius Julianus, I think is his name.
Okay.
Basically, the Praetorian Guard put the seat of emperor up to the highest bidder, and Julianus wins that. I'm sorry, before Didius Julianus, there's Pertinax. And Pertinax gets assassinated, and then Julianus takes the throne from the highest bidder.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, a lot of people don't feel that that's a legitimate way to select an emperor, and it leads to a conflict between the three leading generals, which are Clodius Albinus up in Britain, Piscinius Niger out in Syria,
mm-hmm.
an area that's under contention today. We hear talk of Palmyra and all these other Syrian towns, and they were big in Rome, and they're big with ISIS right now. And the guy who ends up winning the whole kit and caboodle is a guy named Septimius Severus. And the first time I heard the name, I think the audio book, the podcast I'm listening to, pronounced it as Septimus Severus, which sounded cool. I like the name because it kind of sounds like Optimus Prime, right? But then every time after that, he says Septimius. And so I Googled the name, and you find both variations, Septimus and Septimius. Now, Septimus sounds like it means seventh. That's what Wikipedia says.
Yes.
What is the difference between Septimus and Septimius?
That's a good question. I don't know. One sounds like the ordinal adjective, you know, the first, second, third, fourth, those are the ordinal numbers. The mm-hmm. cardinal numbers are 1, 2, 3, 4. Sounds like the ordinal seventh.
For example, Octavius would mean eighth.
Right.
So there's an extra I in there. It wouldn't be Octavus. It's right. Octavius. Why
so is it? So it could be that's how they distinguish between the adjective seventh and the name. Maybe that's how they make it into a name. I'm not sure. I don't know. I hadn't noticed that before.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of times you'll see an I-U-S name.
Okay.
Like Lucius, yeah. Marcius.
Right.
They often.
But then you have Marcus Aurelius.
Yeah.
So it can go either way. Well, if anyone knows, send us an email at info@ecap.us. Okay, moving on. Today we want to talk about a large number of things because there's a lot in the news and we've sort of been prepping some other discussions, so we'll see how far we get because this is sort of the end of the year. As we're recording, it's Army Navy Day, and of course Navy will be an Army, but if you ask my son, Army's going to be Navy, and there's all sorts of holiday festivities going on, Christmas parties and what have you. Oh, did you hear about making sure your holiday party is not a Christmas party in disguise.
It's getting harder and harder to distinguish satirical websites from true news websites.
Right.
It really is.
Well, I thought at reading the headline that it would be a satire, but no, it was real.
It is.
And so there's all of this. I think it's probably from a liberal educational institution telling people to essentially avoid references to specific holidays and holiday traditions. And while they make a brief reference to a menorah, everything else is aimed at Christianity.
Right.
Don't say Merry Christmas. Don't use the colors red and green.
And notice that they are not talking about this is what our institution will or will not do. They're talking about this is how people attending our institution will conduct themselves personally. Okay. So they're telling people not that the school isn't going to celebrate this as part of its institutional schedule, but that the individual people at this school should not be doing this.
Mm-hmm. That's insane. And
it is. Would they tell someone not to be wearing a burqa? Really?
That might offend someone and cause them to come in and blow up your Christmas party.
Can I say offensive things about burqas? I have a few things to say about those. I really don't like them.
I mean, I think that...
But I don't want to get you off track.
I think that the context was an effort to make us more safe so that, you know, I don't even know their names, but the San Bernardino terrorists don't come in and shoot your workplace up.
Right.
So, like everything liberals do, they're well-intended, but they cause great offense with their great intentions, and it really doesn't affect anything.
They're not effective. Yeah. In fact, I think they are counterproductive.
Yeah.
Because they're saying to terrorists, oh, you're going to murder us? Okay. What can we do to make you happy? Oh, you don't want the Christmas tree? Okay, Christmas tree's gone. Mm-hmm. It's just this unbelievable pandering. Whereas what we should be doing is striking back and saying, you know, you 7th century barbarians, we are going to go after you if you do this.
That was a lot I could say about it, but we've got more on the plate. So in that vein, in watching out for terrorists, I want to point out that having aired a recent show on the terrorist attacks from a couple of weeks ago, Kona and I were completely unaware of the San Bernardino attacks that were coming. But we basically predicted it. We were saying how this is just something waiting to happen. We even talked about the idea that people could get guns and then just go walking into places and shooting things up. And this was in response to the Paris attacks, where they essentially just opened fire and started shooting and killed a bunch of people at, I think the band was called the Eagles of Death Metal concert. So, whenever I want to make a sort of morbid joke, I say, yeah, I'm going to an Eagles of Death Metal concert. Coming with me? So they unloaded in Paris, and there, of course, everybody changed their Facebook profile. Facebook has now an app. You can just click on it, and it automatically puts a French flag on your... It overlays it over your picture.
Right.
And people were paying... In some senses, it might have been genuine. In some senses, it might have been... just pop culture homage to the Paris attacks. But then, of course, Black Lives Matter had to come out and say, F Paris, right?
Right, you're taking all of our airtime away from us.
Right. Yeah, you shouldn't be concerned about these white Europeans dying. I'm not even sure if there's a racial analysis of who was there. I'm sure some non-white people died over there. But, you know, pay attention to our black kids because we're getting... called the N-word, you know, by people driving past in trucks. And for that, university presidents must resign. Mm-hmm. So all this is sort of coalescing at the same time. I'm kind of interested that Hillary Clinton, she's made some comments on it, but she's not in the thick of this. And it's either because she's not doing a good job of stealing the limelight or... Donald Trump is just doing such a great job at dominating the stage. And Donald Trump's comments, again, refer back to something we were talking about a couple of weeks ago, because we talked about how the Southern National Congress passed a resolution saying no Muslims. No Muslim immigration, no Muslims here in America. And they even want to some degree, send the ones that are here back. But nobody's really talking about that seriously now. But Donald Trump does want to bring a halt to Muslim immigration. And that has just launched a whole series of attacks on social media and the regular mainstream media and everything else, where the media hasn't stopped covering him. But you've got Josh, not Ernest, coming out and saying, this disqualifies Donald Trump as candidate for president of the United States. And you've got Paul Ryan saying something to the same effect. And you've got Barack Obama, this is not who we are. right? It should be This Is Not Whom We Are, but, you know, we won't.
No, who?
Well, yes. Well.
Okay, okay. We're going to end up in another corner here
Let's have this out.
It is, the verb is the to-be verb, are, like I am, you are, he is. Mm-hmm. That's the present tense. In the past tense, it will be I was, you were, was, were, am, is, are. Mm-hmm. It's a linking verb, and so it doesn't take a direct object. It links from the subject to what's called a predicate noun. Which is a noun, or it could be an adjective, either one, but they are in the same case as the subject. So we'd say, who's who in America? Who is who in America? Mm-hmm. That is correct, because the verb is. It's the to-be verb. So it's linking from a subject to a predicate noun, or pronoun, actually. Whereas if it were an active verb, like there's a bumper sticker that drives me nuts at the pet store. It says, who adopted who? That's me wrong. That's wrong. It should be who adopted whom, because the verb is adopted. And that is an action. It's done to something. So it takes a direct object.
I'm going to disagree with you. Because I thought that way exactly for a long time.
Did somebody correct you somewhere?
Well, there's a lot of debate, and most websites will kind of let you get away with going the way that sounds right. But it's not about the predicate noun issue.
Okay.
It's about what is the subject of the sentence. So let's go back to the age old. I'm coming to the door, and you say, who is it? And I say, it is I.
Yes.
That's the correct
way to say it. That is very good.
Now, the verb is. Uh-huh. It's the same verb. So, if I say, you know, Donald Trump is in that magazine. Well, where is he? That's him. That is he. Okay.
Yes.
He sounds like it. Well, see, he is a, what do you call it, a nominative pronoun? It is the one you use in the subject, because he is the subject of the sentence. That is the object of the verb. So you're really saying he is that, but you're reversing the word order, that is he. Okay, same thing as it is I. I is it, or we would say I am it.
Right.
But of course that just doesn't sound right in English either way. But that is the proper way to say it. So who / whom gets really, really confused, because if we begin the sentence, yes, who is the nominative pronoun version, whom is the object version, but if we say, who is it? Is that correct?
Yes.
No! What's the subject?
It.
It.
Is.
It is whom.
No, it is
whom. Whom is it?
No, who is it? It's correct. Because the verb is still the intransitive linking verb.
All right, so you're talking about non-transitive linking verbs. And I'm saying if you can send me something on that,
I will be happy.
I'll be glad to reconsider my position.
I will.
But as I understand it, and there is the situation that occurs, I've rationalized it in that you have phrases that do this, and sometimes the pronoun that begins the phrase can be the nominative or the subject of the phrase, but the phrase itself is in the object of another sentence. And so you could go either way. But usually it's all one way or it's all the other. It's either all subject or it's all object. So I should write these down.
My students a really mean question on an exam. There was a blank space, and I said, who or whom? You know, you got to choose which one, right? Mm-hmm. Blank. Shall I say is calling.
Ah! Now see, that would be who.
Yes.
Because why? It's the subject.
A subject of what?
No, the whole sentence.
What's the verb?
We'll be back after these messages. Messages. Messages.
Blank. Shall I say is calling.
Ah! Now see, that would be who.
Yes.
Because why? It's the subject.
A subject of what?
No, the whole sentence.
What's the verb?
Well, I would say, shall I say? So I guess say.
Well, it's two sentences, and they're one or two clauses, and one is inside the other one. One clause
you're saying, who is calling?
One clause is, I shall say, and the other clause is, who is calling? Okay. And so we start with that second clause, who, and then we insert, shall I say, and then the rest of the the sentence from the first subject is calling. Mm-hmm. So it is who, but people will get confused about that.
Right. And it wouldn't sound so bad if you said whom at the beginning. Most people would be like, yeah, okay.
Right.
Sounds okay.
Because it'll trick people, because what if you turn it around and take it out of a question format and make it into a statement, you would say, I shall say who is calling. So I shall say, there you have a subject and you have an action verb. I shall say, what am I going to say? I'm not going to say boo. I shall say, and then you have a clause as your direct object. And it's functioning as the direct object of what you're going to say. Who is calling? So that's how you know that the who is the subject of that other clause. So it should not be whom, it should be who. But it's fun to make them fall down and try to puzzle it out. And they love it too, especially if they're good students.
One of the ones that gets me all the time is, I am who I am. Okay, should it be I am whom I am?
No, yeah. It should be I am who.
Why?
Because am is the linking verb. I am who. And then if you say who is calling or who I am, that's your next clause. I am, and then what am I? Now you need a predicate noun or a predicate adjective. You could say I am tall. That's a predicate adjective. You could say I am a teacher. That's a predicate noun. You could say I am who I am.
Okay, well, let me come from my point of view.
All right.
What's the subject?
I.
In both clauses, you've got I am, right? And who is somehow linking them. So in the bigger sentence, is who the subject, or who I am is the subject, or is I am, or is I the subject?
You're right. In the second clause, who I am, I is the subject, am is the linking verb, and who is the predicate noun, or pronoun in this case. Mm-hmm. And that pronoun is functioning as a relative pronoun, which is what when pronouns are used to link clauses together, it works like that.
So I think it's I am whom I am.
I am who I am.
In other words,
who
like,
says that?
Well, every now and then you get it. I mean, it's more likely to say...
that's Popeye, isn't it? I am who I am. Isn't that who says
it? He says, I am what I am. So that's okay.
Well,
there was a show called Red Dwarf, and it was a joke. And this guy comes along and he says...
Just don't trust that machine, man. Look, I know it's old-fashioned, but I'm from the school that believe if God had intended us to fly, he wouldn't have invented Spanish air traffic control. Look, okay, that machine might be able to cure diseases and stuff, but you shouldn't use it to change you into what you're not. You are what you are. Wasn't it Descartes who said, I am what I am?
No, it was Popeye the Sailor Man.
Well, whoever it was, he was a hell of a philosopher. And I think what he was trying to say was... You've got to stay true to what you are. Yeah,
but he says, I am what I am. And then there's a whole like poem that goes along with that. I'm bumped by this other man. But the other version of that is, you could say he is the one that is in the car. But to be grammatically correct, you wouldn't call a person a that. So you would say he is the one who is in the car. But the question then is, should it be who or should it be whom? Okay. He is the one, so obviously he sounds like it's a subject. Who is in the car? If that was all by itself, I'm sorry, I set up a bad one because that's clearly who.
Who?
So who is only who because it's the subject of the second clause, even though the clause is acting as an object of
right.
The verb is.
Uh huh.
So it can get
functioning. It's not an object. This I pound this into my Latin students' heads that the to be verb never ever takes a direct object.
Well, it doesn't take an indirect object.
I don't think so, because indirect objects are used with verbs of giving and telling, which are action verbs. You'd never use an indirect object with a. But what
if I say he is a boy?
You have now.
What is the word boy?
It's a predicate noun. A boy is a thing. Or a person, place, or thing. It's a noun.
Okay, I have to read.
He is boy. Boy is he. You've got a pronoun and a noun. Mm-hmm. He and boy. And they're totally swappable because it's a linking verb. That's one of the things about linking verbs is you can swap your subject and your predicate noun. You can, he is boy. Boy is he. It means the same thing.
Okay. Well, see, everything you're telling me about predicate nouns, that was part of my original set of arguments. So it's coming back to me that it has to have some meaning because otherwise what's the use of a predicate noun, right? Why would my teachers have taught me about predicate nouns except in this particular context? I can't think of any valid reason. So I'm not, you know, I'm leaving the door open that I'm totally wrong and, okay. And you're totally right.
There, all right.
but I'm going to stick by my guns for now.
Okay. There are other linking verbs besides the to be verb.
Okay.
And we use them a lot with adjectives. Like instead of saying she is sad, I might say she appears sad. Mm-hmm. She seems sad. She looks sad.
And these are not action verbs. They're just linking verbs.
They're just linking. And they're linking, in that case, to a predicate adjective. And the predicate adjective modifies the noun that is the subject. It links back through that linking verb. It links back to the subject. You either rename the subject with a predicate noun, mm-hmm. or you modify the subject with a predicate adjective. Now, either way, it's pointing back at the subject.
I understand that. Predicate adjectives, I'm all over.
Okay.
Predicate nouns is the one. It's something I read a couple years ago when I was dealing with this who is whom thing, totally dispelled everything I had believed before about predicate nouns.
Oh.
And so now I have
probably
to.
Some communist propaganda in the government schools.
No, it was online. It was online, but. I was trying to figure out what the right usage was, and the digger I dug, the more confused it gets. So I just basically concluded that it had to be a object, or what do you call it, a subject or object thing, and of course the problem occurs when you have something like a word like who, or a word like he, or a word like I, even we sometimes, in a place that just doesn't feel right to use the object version, and so we use the subject version instead. So just along those lines, two other things that I was fascinated by: I before E, except after C.
And when it says A as a neighbor in way.
There you go. But I will still give you an exception. And I was talking with a good friend, Collins Bailey, about this. And I said, well, and when you're engaging in a siege.
Oh. Or if something's weird. I used to think that weird was at one time.
No, it's a seizure. Except when you're having a seizure. Siege is spelled correctly. Seizure is not.
You're right. I wonder if at one time it was pronounced seizure. Just like I wonder if weird used to be pronounced weird.
Right.
Like way.
Yeah. And then Collins Bailey came back and he said, okay, tell me a word where you have a C followed by, what we'll call them, a soft vowel, like I think it's an I or E, where it doesn't have the S sound. Okay. And I thought for hours and hours, and I couldn't find it. I was like, there's always an exception. There's always an exception. I could not find the exception. Now, you can obviously go into, like, Scipio Africanus, right? Yeah. Let's go into other languages and find it, but I could not find the example in English. Ice, you know, S sound, you know. So, with that, those are language and grammar lessons. We're going to move on now to a variety of topics. A email just came across my screen from the Calvert County Republican Men's Club, I think. They are hosting on December 14th. By the time this airs, this will be in the past, but this is this coming Sunday. A certain Navy SEAL, the question is, can a Navy SEAL defeat Steny Hoyer? And this Navy SEAL's name happens to be, on at least as far as the FEC is reporting, Christopher Beck. But of course, he doesn't go by the name Christopher Beck. He goes by the name Kristen Beck. It's kind of like one of those Caitlin things, right? Navy SEAL, highly decorated, proved himself a manly man, and then I guess decided he didn't want to be a man anymore. So he has, again, I don't know how far he's gone in operation, but he's dyed his hair blonde, grown it out, put on some lipstick, and probably a dress. There's a movie out here called Lady Valor, and he is therefore running for Congress as a woman. And my frustration is not so much that any of this is happening or that this person will be running for Congress. We had a Dana something or other running for Montgomery County Council for several years, and most recently, I think she ran for ran for state senate. Okay. Ran against Rich Madaleno, who's openly gay himself. So it's kind of
so
like
he's trying to one up him.
What's the difference, right? Didn't win. But now we have Kristen Beck doing the same thing against Steny Hoyer. And again, I'm kind of in the same category. I don't think Steny Hoyer is a homosexual, but he certainly votes in lockstep with them all the time. And Christopher Beck is running as a Democrat. I'm thinking, why is the Calvert County Republican Central Committee hosting him, listening to him, or even entertaining his thoughts? And it's probably, you know, hey, we need a speaker. This guy might draw people to us. Of course, the email uses all the wrong pronouns, identifies him as a her, he is a she, and Sakona's comment about Z. I've seen many various variations on that. And instead of calling them Mr. or Ms., you call them MX.
How do I wouldn't even want to guess how to pronounce
it. I have
that.
No idea. Mix? Yeah, probably mix, right?
Mix. So,
but it's unfortunately no laughing matter. It's where we are today. It's the mainstream. It's what Barack Obama is pushing and Hillary Clinton after him. And you don't hear Donald Trump saying a word about it. Tell you where his part. Oh, got to say this. Uh-huh. So I'm listening to Mark Levin last night. Mm-hmm. And guy calls in, and I couldn't tell whether he was black or white, but he said his brother was black, which under most circumstances causes you to think, well, he must be black.
Who do we have? Jay, Long Beach, California. Go ahead.
Donald Trump is being normal because what is norm now is really radical. It's really out of control. Transgender, gay marriage. My brother is a homosexual. He's African American. He speaks and articulates well. He hates, you know, people speaking ebonics, changing this culture. He really loves being American, and he fought for this country also. I mean, he was in the Army. This guy is ripped. We are in love with your show. I mean, you are God's gift to this nation. I mean, I was in the Navy, too. I love being a part of this nation. I do not want to take advantage in any way. And, you know, I have Muslim friends. They're very nice, and they are outraged by this, too. And to be honest, a lot of Muslims are conservatives. They are not. Transgender, gay marriage. Yeah, yeah.
Let me tell you something. In my book signings, Muslims come up to me, quite frankly, many of them from Africa.
So this is yet another caller who has called in and said, I'm a conservative. These people I know are conservatives. They're good guys. They're just gay. And I think that the fact that he kept bringing this up was an effort to say, hey, you conservatives, you need to get over the gay thing because we're all on the same team because we're conservative. And this is something that has bothered me for a while. If you are gay, you are a liberal that just hasn't hatched yet. You may be a fiscal conservative all your life. You may love bombing Iran or whatever it is you think makes you conservative. You may be that all your life, but there is inherent in your philosophy something that's going to make you reject conservatism, root and branch, because you don't accept the moral code that conservatism is based on. All right, with that, we'll be back in a minute. Welcome back to the show. Conan and I were having a discussion about some people that are active in the Republican Party today. When these kind of people come forth and say, I am a strong conservative and I support gay marriage.
Yeah.
It doesn't take anything to go from that to say, I am a strong conservative and I support illegal immigration. I am a strong conservative and I support importing Muslim Syrian refugees into the country.
And I support wage and price control.
There you go.
You know, it just goes on and on and on. Yeah.
And to that point, I recently audiobooked Animal Farm.
Ah.
And it's a lot more than all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. That's the end. That's the tagline. But there are so many more valuable things in it. It's not what it could have been, or it seemed like there was more that should have been there. So you have this farm. It starts off, and the animals overthrow the farmer, mm-hmm. Farmer Jones, And then the pigs are the most intelligent, and they put themselves in charge.
Community organizers. The community organizers.
Okay. Okay. See, I haven't even thought that level.
I'm just making fun of
him. No, that's good.
I don't think he uses that expression.
And there's a couple of horses. The main one is Boxer. He's the hard worker, and it doesn't matter what happens or how bad things go, he says, "I will work harder." And later on, he adds to that Napoleon is always right. So those are his two slogans. I will work harder, and Napoleon. Napoleon is what becomes the lead pig.
Yeah.
Before Napoleon is a lead pig, there's one called Snowball. And Snowball was there at the fight with Farmer Jones. He took some shotgun shot to his back and so forth. He fought bravely. But after a turn of events happens, he disappears. And being not there to defend himself, he becomes, there was a difference of opinion over whether or not to build the windmill.
Uh-huh.
And Snowball wanted to build the windmill, drew up all the plans and everything. Napoleon was against it. And I think this was probably a window into what was going on between Stalin, Trotsky, and Lenin, specifically Trotsky, who they just made him an enemy.
Yes.
And hounded him. And I think they killed him.
Assassinated him. Yes. Yeah, they killed him in Mexico with a pickaxe, I think.
Wow.
Pretty brutal.
So that's my clearest association there. And it was that Napoleon, no matter what it was that Snowball wanted to do, Napoleon just opposed it. And Snowball decided we were going to build this windmill. And at first you're thinking, this is not going to work. These are animals. But Eric Arthur Blair, or George Orwell, he doesn't deal with the mechanics of it all. He just talks about them holding things and carrying things as if they have hands. And this is sort of where it kind of loses a little bit of believability, because I can't imagine a pig holding a glass of beer, let alone any kind of work tools needed to build something. And, you know, how's the horse? If the horse is pulling rocks up the hill to build a windmill, how does he put himself in the harness? You know, mm-hmm. he doesn't deal with any of that. But after the battle, it's the Battle of the Farmhouse, I think. After that battle, Snowball disappears. And being that Napoleon was always at odds with him, he starts blaming every bad thing that happens on Snowball.
Oh.
And whenever food is has disappeared, or wherever mischief has occurred, he says, "Oh, I think Snowball was here. You know, I smell his footprints." You know, and so some people were saying, "But didn't you know? How could Snowball have been plotting treason against the animals? How could he have been siding with Farmer Jones? I remember him taking a shotgun shot to his back, and the blood. I remember that." And this other pig comes along, his name is Squealer, and he's like, no, you're obviously mistaken, you know, it wasn't that, Snowball, you know, he did these things to make it look like he was on our side, but really, he was in league with Farmer Jones all along, and, you know, the story progresses, and he gets some dogs, he puts them off to the side, raises the dogs all on his own, and then they come out totally loyal to him, and anybody who gets in his way gets killed. Things go missing, the hens won't lay eggs, the dogs kill them. And first they have to confess. They have to confess to being in league with Farmer Jones or one of the other farmers and plotting treason against Animal Farm and just mercilessly kill them. And what really kind of got me were the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
Because all throughout the story, the sheep have this slogan, "Four legs good, two legs bad, four legs good, two legs bad." Well, at the end of the story, Napoleon brings all the pigs into the farmhouse. And first it was like, no one's going to live in the farmhouse. They changed that law. Then it was like, no animals shall sleep in a bed. They changed that law. And then the last law is, you know, no animal shall walk on 2 feet. And of course, by the end of the book, the pigs come out walking on 2 feet and wearing clothes and doing all these other things that animals weren't supposed to do. And at that moment, the sheep changed their slogan to "four legs good, two legs better." And I was like, is that America? Is that America?
Yes. That is the human condition.
And that was a perfect analogy, making them the sheep.
Yeah.
Okay. The only other thing, the sort of loose end that never was really followed up on, there was a crow, I think it was a crow, called Moses. And he was always considered a spy for Farmer Jones. Mm-hmm. He would tell the animals of a place that all animals went when they died, called Sugar Candy Mountain. I don't know, was George Orwell criticizing this whole heaven thing, or is that just an unfinished plot element? Mm-hmm. You know, obviously he's meant to be filling their heads with false dreams of place they won't go. And oh, by the way, Boxer, he works all his life, just as hard as he can, just pulling stones up that hill, building that windmill, working when other people aren't working or other animals aren't working, until one day his strength gives out and he just collapses on the side of a hill, not able to do anymore. And it's at that moment that you figure, oh, you know, they've already talked about plans for retirement. He's going to go into this other pasture over here and be taken care of, and they've got a pension. And then the author reveals to us, but, you know, we've never seen anybody go into retirement. No one's ever reached retirement before. And certainly Boxer will merit retirement. He's mm-hmm. worked harder than anybody, and he's never complained. And whenever anything went wrong, he says, I will work harder. And Napoleon is always right. So certainly he will get retirement. And the next day, a van shows up, and they put Boxer in the van. And just as the van is driving off, the donkey is one of the few animals that I can actually read. And he's like, don't you see what that van says? It says, horse slaughterer and glue manufacturer, you know. And they're yelling and trying to get the horse to break out, but he wasn't able to break out. And they basically send him off to his death. And of course, Napoleon lies about it, and you know, so, oh, he went to the hospital and developed an illness, and yeah, we weren't able to bring him back. I'm sorry. And no, we can't even bring the body back to have it buried here. So, and you know, again, Bin Laden, you know, nobody, no crime, right? What in there is unlike what we are experiencing with our government today? So I'm very impressed with how prescient
yes.
Orwell was, and it could well be that this is how all communist regimes, or even all, because it doesn't even seem for a while that he's criticizing communism. I mean, the whole goal of Animal Farm was all animals are equal, getting to that point of equality.
Right.
And therefore, communism in and of itself, the goal of communism anyway, that, you know, we would be equal, we would share, we would work, you know, it's kind of like a communist commune. Everyone's working because they want to do what's best for the community and the society. That's all exemplified therein. The bad part is the pigs, Napoleon and his crew, who are essentially scraping off the top. They are taking the fruits of everybody else's labor, and they're saying, oh, yeah, you know, we'll get you your payback soon. Just, you know, just keep working. We'll get that windmill built soon. Just keep working, you know? And meanwhile, he's making backroom deals with the humans. But on that note, this whole idea of communist utopia was covered in a audio book called yes. Das Kapital. And we both listened to it now. It's a book about Das Kapital. And it, I think this, the two central points in it, Simon talks about Karl Marx's life and how he ended up in England and mm-hmm. what he was seeking to do. But at the core of his theory is the labor theory of value.
Right.
And then later on he comes to the surplus theory of value. And it is this notion that something ought to be worth the amount of labor, the amount of man hours put into creating it.
But you have to value the labor first, right? I mean, where do you get the value for that? Labor has different value. You know, is the value of a cleaning woman no different than the value of an engineer? And if they have different values, where does that value come from? Why would you pay an engineer more than you would a cleaning woman?
Well, this is the sort of paradox that the narrator gives near the end of the book when he's talking about surplus value. Because basically Karl Marx comes to the conclusion that everything, so basically you have a product that you're making, if you sell that product, it should pay the cost for the worker to make that. It turns out that A worker may only need to work half the day to earn his entire value and earn his entire keep. Everything above that is surplus. And he therefore concludes that the employer takes the surplus for himself. Everything earned above the actual value of the market good is what he's calling interest. And that value is something that these greedy capitalists wish to hoard for themselves. And obviously, it's bad, it's unjust, and what have you. But he then goes on to say, when you have a person who labors, let's say they labor for the same amount of time, and one person produces a porcelain statue, and another person produces an amount of rock, let's say out of a quarry, and let's say that they're roughly the same size and same weight, and they took the same amount of time to produce, but that this porcelain statue sells for five times what the rock sells for. Why is that? And his answer was because Karl Marx concluded that the training and everything that went into learning how to make porcelain statues was worth five times the training and everything that went into learning how to pull out the same equivalent of rock out of a quarry. And the author then points out, or actually he's quoting an Austrian economist mm-hmm. on this, and he says, this is circular logic. You're basically saying the porcelain statue is five times more than the rock because everything that went into the porcelain statue is five times more valuable than what went into making the rock, and you really haven't explained to me why the porcelain statue sells for five times more.
Right. I mean, it's just completely backwards. That's why it's so hard for me to listen to, because how could anybody have believed this? Other than the fact, I give him the excuse that economics wasn't very well developed at the time, and so he didn't have the advantage that I have of not only experiencing markets myself, but of reading people who explain to me how they work. And it's just obvious. You know, markets change all the time. So the statue may be really valuable unless there's some sort of crash and people have to spend their money on other more important things, and so then the statue's value is going to drop. It has nothing to do with the labor put into it. It could be that one guy puts a whole bunch of two different sculptors, one, they both spend the same amount of time. One guy produces a sculpture that people like, and so it's valuable, they want to buy it. Another guy produces artwork, a sculpture that nobody likes. This happens all the time in history. How many famous painters do we know who never made any money in their lifetime because people didn't appreciate their work? And whether or not people appreciate the work, that has to do with what's going on in the market. That years later, once people began to appreciate the work, that created a market for it, so then the value went way up. Has zero, zip, nada to do with the amount of time or the value of the labor put into making the art.
To me, all value is subjective. All value. And if you don't
yes.
begin it by saying, you know, what's my treasure might be your trash, if you don't begin it by recognizing that, you're going to come up with a failed philosophy. Well, we will delve deeper into the intricacies of capitalism and communism and philosophical thought in a future show. Until then, keep fighting for freedom.
And keep the faith. Keep the faith. Keep the faith.